The ring Z3X is an infinite ring. There's infinitely many elements in there. Why? Because the elements are polynomials in X with coefficients from Z3. So all the coefficients are either 0, 1, or 2. But because the degree of the polynomial can be arbitrarily high, second degree is quadratic, third degree is cubic, fourth degree is quartic, fifth degree is quintic, sixth degree is what? Hextic, etc. 10th degree, 100th degree, a millionth degree, a Googleth degree. Okay, degree is arbitrarily high. There are definitely infinitely many elements of this ring. Though it does have something called a finite characteristic. I'll let you think about that based on the reading. I'm not going to talk about that. It's got a characteristic of 3. You read about that or should have read about that. It's got principal ideals in it that are generated by elements. You can always do that kind of thing, just like you can always make cyclic groups, subgroups generated by elements in group theory. And the example ideal that we, principal ideal that we mod by here to create a factor ring is the principal ideal generated by x squared plus 1. It's an ideal by definition, because this is a commutative ring with unity. And think about the notation we're using here. This is all polynomial multiples of x squared plus 1. In other words, another way to think of that is this is every polynomial you can think of that has x squared plus 1 as a factor, is what this notation represents. For example, you know, x to the fourth plus x squared would be an element of that. Why? Because it's x squared times that polynomial. Another example would be, oh, say x minus 3 times x squared plus 1 in factored form. It's clear why that's an element of this ideal. But in unfactored form, if you multiply it out, it wouldn't be so clear right away. If you multiply it out, it's x cubed minus 3x squared plus x minus 3. It's not so clear just looking at that, that it's an element of this principal ideal. But because you can factor it, and it has x squared plus 1 as a factor, it is. X squared plus 1, in fact, divides x cubed minus 3x squared plus x minus 3. You read about ring divisibility. Very important. So this is a principal ideal generated by x squared plus 1. It's definitely an ideal. As we've seen today, you can definitely make the factor ring. What is this factor ring like? That's the question. Well, first of all, its elements take the form of, well, cosets. Whether you're talking factor groups or factor rings, the elements are cosets. You could say it's all cosets of this form, where f of x varies over all of z3x. Because f of x can be arbitrarily high degree, it might seem like, therefore, this is an infinite ring. But that presumption would be faulty. This is actually a finite ring. In fact, it's even a field, a finite field. Why? When you've got, it turns out, this takes proof. I'm not going to fully prove this, but I will hint at the proof. That the cosart representative here, the arbitrary f of x, can always be simplified, you might say. You can find another representative that's much, much simpler. If f of x happens to have a very high degree, for example. You can always, in fact, use linear coset representatives, where the a and the b, the coefficients of that linear polynomial, are from Z3, and therefore this has got to be a finite set. Because those are just two numbers, a and b, that are from the same finite set, Z3, consisting of 0, 1, and 2. In fact, there's three choices for A, there's three choices for B. There's 3 squared, 9 elements in this factor ring. Therefore, you could say the order of this factor ring, if we use order notation, is 9. There are 9 elements. Already it is 3 squared initially. There are 9 elements of this factor ring. Though, again, this part takes proof. What kind of proof? Again, I'm not going to completely do the proof today. Maybe we will next week. What kind of proof? It's based on the fact that this is an ideal, really. You can simplify things like this. One thing you can do is you can, for example, simplify x squared plus 1 plus the ideal as just x squared plus 1, the ideal. Why? Because x squared plus 1 is definitely in there. It gets sucked in. This is nothing other than AH equals H if and only if A is an H. It's a property of cosets. I'm not actually even using the fact that this is an ideal there, just that it's a subgroup additively. You also could, a little informal calculation here, effectively add negative 1 to both sides of this. It's also true that x squared plus the ideal equals negative 1 plus the ideal. How could you justify that? That's sort of an informal justification. I imagined adding negative 1 to both sides. Did I really do that? Not really. What's a more formal justification of this? It's related to another property of cosets. You remember this property? AH equals BH if and only if A inverse B is an H, which is also true if and only if B inverse A is an H. That's what I'm really using here. The A is, say, this thing. The H is this. This is, say, this is the B, and this is the H, using additive notation here because we're talking a factor ring. We always use additive notation for our cosets. Why are these things equal? They'd be equal if this is one of these two is true. And yes, both of those are true because using additive notation, A minus B is x squared minus negative 1 is x squared plus 1. And as we saw up here, x squared plus 1 is definitely in the ideal. That would be the reason why we could do the informal calculation of subtracting 1 from both sides. We also could do another informal calculation. We could take this thing and we could multiply both sides by x. And the claim would be that x cubed plus the ideal, that coset is the same as negative x plus the ideal. What did I do? Informally speaking, I took this equation and multiplied both sides by x, multiplying the representative by x, not the ideal itself. That just stays there all the time. And I claim this is true. Why? It should be based on the same idea. In particular, if this is the A and this is the B, and I compute A minus B, that's x cubed minus negative x, or x cubed plus x. That should be an element of H. This is the H. It should be a polynomial multiple of x squared plus 1. It is. Yes, factor out the x. It's a polynomial multiple of x squared plus 1. Done. So in other words, I can always simplify x cubed to negative x, effectively, when doing calculations in this factor ring. Likewise, you could also simplify if you multiply both sides by x to the fourth. X to the fourth plus the ideal to negative x squared plus the ideal. And by the way, I also could simplify these in other ways using the fact that the coefficients are in Z3. I could also rewrite this one as 2x plus the ideal, because negative 1 equals 2 mod 3. Likewise, I could simplify this one to 2x squared plus the ideal, once again, because negative 1 equals 2 mod 3. This can be generalized to higher and higher powers of x on more complicated expressions. You know, maybe in front of the ideal, you have x to the fifth plus 2x to the fourth plus x cubed, et cetera, plus the ideal. That you can always simplify it using these kinds of calculations. That's what the example's about. And that's ultimately related to being able to prove this.